We gotta figure out how to get this one. This is the hero shot.
Since everybody's back.
This week we get. The bullet, when the gun hits, the bullet ricochets. Maybe hits this, goes right through, hits the metal. Big spark. Maybe goes right through her legs, hits the metal with a big spark, and then everybody just kind of ducks. And that gives him the moment.
We actually came on to Indiana Jones as some of the first people involved. Steven would sit down with us and he'd say, I've got an Area 51 environment, and I want this to be in South Nevada, and I've got a diner, and I've got these characters. I've got Mutt, Mac, Oxley, obviously Indy and Marion. And here are the bad guys, here are the good guys. But it was funny because even though we knew a lot about what was going on, I never really had access to the script or any grand plan until much later in the process. So it sort of unfolded in front of us, you know, as sort of this mystical thing.
Now we have to see it unrolling though. He's got to fall out of frame. We've got to see the thing unrolling.
Steven almost knows exactly what he wants right from the beginning. And just tells you what it is.
Look, look, bam.
Bam, that's good. Now, I'll tell you something else I would do. I'd carry them in. I would pan them in. Instead of just holding on this, I'd pan them in, because remember, they're running.
Yeah.
They're running, so just take them down one of those aisles and just pan them into this frame.
Steven would draw things for us, and Steven's drawings are very rudimentary, but the amazing part is that they all work. He'll sit down and he'll sketch out just a little one-minute drawing about a shot. Put a frame around it, and that's your framing, and then you'll do A, B, and C positions. And you go into Maya and do the 3D world, and it works. I mean, the lens works, the framing works, the timing works, everything works.
And then we cut in and he catches her.
Oh, okay.
And then we have dialogue like old times. He looks at her and smiles, says like old times.
And then to have that transcribe into an actual 3D working shot is pretty incredible. And that's basically how the process works.
But you know, we don't have the geography of how this happened. So just have him stand up and get ready to, you know, time his jump.
Steven is definitely the focal point for the entire production. And through him, not only is our work important for Steven to help him flesh out his ideas, but then that work gets distilled and brought into all the different departments that cascade down from him. And they have this foundation and this start from which to, you know, begin the process.
Well, I said to my cameraman, Janusz Kaminski, let's not move Indiana Jones into a 21st century techno thriller. Indiana Jones has to stay traditional. And in order to do that, let's not change the lighting style from what Douglas Slocum established on the first three adventures. And he was on board for that.
We sat down at the screening room here at Amblin and we watched the previous three movies. And it was just an amazing ride to see, you know, not just how the story progresses, but how the technology advances and how certain things became new, but yet there's a consistency in all the three stories, which is basically the visual representation of the story. It's very glamorous, it's very warm, it's very kind of high key. It's an action adventure, it's occasionally suspenseful and dark, but it's never too dark and it's never too bright. It's got this very specific Hollywood glossy look to the picture.
I hadn't worn the Indiana Jones costume for 18 years. And early in our production process, the costume was sent to my house for me to try on to see where we would have to change sizes. And I put it on and it fit like a glove. I felt really comfortable and ready to go.
With the iconic look of Indiana Jones, there's no updating really, except if you go back to Indiana 1 and 2 and 3, you're going to see nuanced differences in his look. And I was under great pressure for me to try to duplicate an iconic picture, and I had to come up with the right stuff. And through referrals and referrals, I ended up with a guy named Stephen Delk in Mississippi, and he came up with the perfect hat, great, great hat body, heavyweight and everything. And so I said, are you up to making me 30 of them? Well, I'll certainly try. I got a few hats in, and we did a screen test on all of his new clothes. And the first thing Steven said when he saw the hat was, oh, great. He said, I lost sleep over thinking you would be able to come up with the hat, and I'm thrilled to death with the way the hats came out, and everybody seems to be happy with them. And the jackets, I found a guy named Tony Novak, and he came up with the greatest jacket. Everything was to perfection. And again, one of the sweetest guys. I said, now, can you do 30 of them? Yeah, I can do whatever you want. He brought me samples, and we picked out a sample of what color we wanted, and we did a few extra oversized in case we had to have extra padding. And he did a wonderful, wonderful job.
The hat is great, the whip is great. Harrison looks great in the hat with the jacket holding the whip.
You could take a still from each of the four movies of him in the hat and the coat, a full shot, and I don't think he'd be able to figure out which one was which, because he looks just like he did in all the other movies.
Hey, isn't that great? Something like this is what the, is what we need to release first. Okay. We start releasing what Harrison looks like in the costume.
Mutt enters Indiana Jones' life on a Harley Davidson, just like Marlon Brando in The Wild One. We even gave him a little bit of the Brando motorcycle hat. He comes out of a cloud of steam from a train about to leave the station. And I had no second choice for Mutt. When I saw Shy and Holes with my kids years ago, the Disney film, I actually said, he'd be great in an Indiana Jones movie. And DreamWorks put him in with DJ Caruso, the director of Disturbia, and later encouraged Michael Bay to use him in Transformers. I sent George Lucas dailies from Disturbia. George saw the dailies, loved Shia, and said, go ahead and cast him.
Literally, the direction, the preparation that I got from Steven was, welcome to Indiana Jones. He wrote a little note on my script that said, okay, now it's time to transform yourself into Mutt, signed Steven. And he gave me three movies. He gave me Blackboard Jungle, Rebel Without a Cause, and The Wild One.
There was just some films that I thought would inform him of the period that we were making our film in, not trying to imitate that movie.
When we started, what was going to take the most time, and we knew what was going to take the most time, would be the sword fight.
So hard, man. God.
Which kept evolving. We'd be moving so fast in training that the ideas started changing. Steven started going, okay, hold on, why don't we add this? Let's put two trucks here, let's put it in the jungle.
Start the whole move back here, yeah.
The way that we had started was like a stand-up fight on the ground, and where we've ended up now is a whole different thing.
That would be perfect.
The goal is to get it to bounce off the shoe, you know?
Steven said at the beginning, we're gonna give you a switchblade. And we didn't have a switchblade coach, but I was able to take the knife home every night. So just me messing around with it, it became like my Tetris. It became the most interesting thing to do on set. It just became my video game. And I got pretty good with it. It just became like a fun thing. And I started showing Steven, oh, that's awesome. We're gonna add it somewhere. So that's how that came in.
I had no predisposition about Shia when I heard that he was Steven's choice to play my son. And I was comfortable with that because I have that degree of confidence in Steven. And he has turned out to be an inventive, unique personality with a real storytelling sensibilities, but also just a sweet guy. So it's been a pleasure to work with him, and it's been a pleasure to spend time with him.
The first time that I had seen Harrison in full regalia was Harrison flew in on his helicopter, and you look up and you hear the ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, and you know it's Harrison. And he gets out of the helicopter, and he takes about 5-6 steps, and he goes, oh, wait. And he walks back to the helicopter, opens the door, and then he reaches for something, and he pulls the whip out, and he untangles the whip, and he looks at it, and he greases it, and he holds it, and you're going, oh my God, this is so real. You're like shaking, your hands are shaking. You've just seen him do whip practice.
The whip came back pretty easily, too. I wasn't surprised, because it's a relatively uncommon skill. And I was able to bring it back in a couple of weeks of pretty diligent application.
We did a costume and makeup test on Harrison, and I had to kind of walk out of the light a few feet just to take a few deep breaths before going back to work. Because seeing him looking that good, it was kind of like, what happened to the last 19 years? How the heck did they go by that fast? My God. And that was scary, but it was also beautiful. And it was something we all shared together.
The people who are working on this film, the core group of us, you know, we're on the first Indiana Jones. We've known each other even before that, so we've known each other over 30 years. So it's a very family-type group.
To do it again with the same people is a mark of the respect that you have for what they've brought to the table. And so to be reunited with George and Steven and Kathy and Frank, who are the original producers, is a great delight.
In keeping this movie to the tradition of the other films, I went back to my earliest producer, Frank Marshall, who produced Raiders of the Lost Ark and was very active on the other two movies, executive producing, and we had a great reunion. But of course, we were never that far away from each other. Our families have stayed close. We do carpool. Kathy, as you know, has produced a lot of my movies. So it's not like it was unusual for Frank, Kathy, and I to work together again, because we never stopped working together.
I think that's the interesting thing about this series is that because so many of us work together, Frank, who I'm now married to because we met on the first Raiders.
Kathy and Frank, you know, they met on the first Indiana Jones and then eventually got married. And Kathy's been working with Steven ever since. And, you know, so this is like a reunion of all of us coming back together again after all these years. And it's been a huge amount of fun.